You've seen all the footage, you've seen it, dude is real. You know what I'm saying? Down with Grand Funk, 71. Kept it real. Dope. Howie's the man, you know what I'm saying? Howie's a survivor. Howie's been through fucking hell. You know what I'm saying? And Howie comes up at shows now, he's chilling out, you know what I'm saying? He's got a great attitude. Life is beautiful.
Yo, Uncle Howie, for real, that's like the original goon right there. If it wasn't for him, there'd be no nonfiction, there'd be no Uncle Howie records, there'd be no psychological, there'd be no Ill Bill, there'd be no Necro. He was the man that set it off. And for those that don't know out there, he's actually the real, true, and living, actual uncle of Ill Bill and Necro.
And I talked to that cat about everything from, like, prison to politics. We talk about media. We do Coalition, Uncle Howie and I.
And we talk about women.
Yeah, we talk about women and all types of stuff. You know what I mean? Uncle Howie, I can have a conversation with that cat about anything. Anything. He always has something profound to say.
And we try and keep him off the streets, keep him clean. We appreciate the concern and the drugs being offered, but really, like, chill.
Uncle Howie moved in with me about 6 months ago. You know what I'm saying? He don't have the needle in his arm no more. He don't have the crack pipe hidden in his sock. You know what I'm saying? He's back in effect. He's retired, but at the same time, he's reborn. You know what I'm saying? He's risen from the flames. You know what I'm saying? He's regenerated from the ashes. Uncle Howie Records, you know what I'm saying, is getting him open right now. So it's like the fucking battery in his back right now. He don't need drugs. He's living off of fucking music. He's living off of studio sessions, live shows, all of that shit. You know what I'm saying? If he wants to smoke some weed, ain't nothing wrong with that. That's all good. You know what I'm saying? But, word up, that's my uncle. He's a survivor. That's why we named the label Uncle Howie Records. Because everything we do and everybody we're involved with is about survival and survivors and motherfuckers that have been through mad shit. But no matter what, we're still here. You know what I'm saying? We're still doing it, laying it down, and that's what's up.
Yo, what's up? I'm Uncle Howie, man. And I want to talk about my homeboys, Nonfiction. I think they're great. You know, I'm only back into hip-hop couple of months, 6 months, 7 months that I'm clean now, and you know, when I'm home, I listen to Nonfiction, you know, because it's more than just hip-hop, man. They're hard motherfuckers. Like me, I'm just a motherfucker now, but they're hard motherfuckers. I said it before and I'll say it again, Nonfiction music is good for everybody. The shit is dope. If you want a cop, get some dope shit, Nonfiction shit. You know what I'm saying? You get the best rush you can get, and you ain't got to put a needle in your arm.
So you caught me out there. This is what happens when you're on the road for a month, and you got the favorite kicks. These are my favorite kicks, classics. Can't find these everywhere. You know what I'm saying? You got a little scuffed up, a little dirty, so you got...
It's like this, man. It's like hip-hop nowadays is like fast food, you know? You get your quick fix, you eat a burger, you get a rush, it's kind of poisonous, but people really like it.
You want a meal, you know what I'm saying? You want to eat, you want to get full. You want something you can chew on, something that's dope. You know what I'm saying? All this shit is like fast food, it's garbage. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to name names, but I mean, you listen to it, you hear it, it's disposable. You can't listen to it more than 5 times. It ain't classic, it ain't dope. You know, we're hitting you with food. You know what I'm saying? Sandwich type, boar's head.
Well, most cats that are putting records out nowadays are just doing what we call fast food music. It's like it's disposable. I mean, Master Ace said it best, disposable arts. It's like no one's putting the time and energy into making a classic album. Everyone's just like, you know, okay, let me get this money. Let me just knock out these joints, put an album out. There's some cats that's putting out 2-3 albums in 1 year. You know, a lot of cats have different aliases and they're doing like so many albums all over the place. For me, it's like it waters down the whole... You know, the whole state of where everything is right now.
We bring you that hip-hop that's pure, that hip-hop that's, you know, between production and lyrics and just concepts that you don't get every day. You know, we're not your average, you know, MC that you're gonna see all over the video box, you know what I mean? Or all here all over the radio.
A lot of the hip-hop coming out right now, man, sounds corny, man. It's like everybody's using the same sound cards, everybody's fucking sampling the same fucking keyboard sounds. And it's just like fucking watered down, rehashed. It all sounds like a fucking chicken McNugget, man. And fuck all that, man. We're like a fucking 12-course meal. When you hear our album, each fucking song is like a different course in a meal that you're having with your family. Like some family reunion type shit.
My boy Phil for the DVD.
Grew up in a scumbag neighborhood, surrounded by scumbags, with a scumbag elevator, with piss in it every day, and fucking beer bottles in it every night. And that's what made me the fucking scumbag that I am today. And I'm proud of it. I'm proud to be a scumbag.
Hi, Mom.
See, I came to New York when I was 4 and a half years old. I was born in Guaynabo, Puerto Rico. And,
It's me right here in Glenwood Projects right now. You know what I'm saying? 5714 Farragut Road. This is where I grew up, you know what I'm saying? This is where I was living when I met Gore-Tex, you know what I'm saying? We grew up together.
I'm from Providence, Rhode Island, from 79 to like...
I grew up in Long Beach, which is on Long Island, and Long Beach was pretty much a diverse mix of people. You had all different kinds of people. You had white, black, Spanish, you know what I'm saying, Indians. Everybody lived together. There was no real segregation. You know, shit out there was ill. You know, you definitely had an old school scene. You know, that's where I was first exposed to graffiti first, mainly. You know, break dancers. That's actually funny because graffiti actually inspired me before any of the four elements or whatever. You know, some chick on a bus, probably like 1978, okay? Some hippie chick with a fucking cocaine hat and a sundress, you know what I'm saying? I'm with Mom Dukes, like sitting in the back of the bus going to like Roosevelt Field, you know? Chick sits down and I can't really see what she's doing. She pulls out a magnum like this, with ink like this, and takes a fucking fly-ass tag on the window. Alright, I couldn't see what it says. I got up and it said Sugar Hill Crew, some shit, like 79s, some crazy shit. That alone, for whatever reason, that was a mad inspiration. You know, she was a chick and that she was crazy ill, you know. That was my first kinda introduction to that lifestyle, you know, me being mad intrigued, 5, 6 years old, wanting to pick up records. And in the early 80s, though, it was a good foundation for hip-hop, for anybody being 8, 9, 7, 10, whatever. If you wanted to be exposed to music, there was a scene that was growing. And, you know, you have breakdancers, MCs, artists, all that. And that inspired me, you know what I'm saying? My cousin was into that, you know, he used to DJ a little bit. He showed me a little shit, he used to throw little parties, had bitches over, you know. And he was basically the first cat that played me Apache. And, you know, for hearing it for the first time on the original record, you know, it devastated me. I hadn't heard anything like it. It wasn't just like a b-boy jam. It just, for some reason, it encapsulated the whole idea of hip-hop, breakdancing, graffiti in one jam. So every time you heard it, you know what I'm saying, it was just hip-hop, hip-hop, hip-hop.
Starting with the living room, first batch of records. Voila. Got more joints. Yeah. Oh yeah, don't forget about these ones down here. And running out of space, so had to fill up the kitchen too. And of course, we got more. We got more records. More records. More records. Yeah, that's that. And then lastly, we got the actual little studio pre-pro room and more records. So this is where, you know, I come up with all my thoughts and concepts and ideas and stuff like that. You know, got my equipment here. Got the old school S950. Got the S1000 up here that many cats ain't got in a keyboard module, you know what I'm saying? The Akai S1000 sampling keyboard. Actually, a lot of my old school remixes, I used to sample full length vocals in this and just drop it on top of the tracks. Got the SP12 down there. That's what I use to work on tracks. When I do get around to working on tracks, you know, it's been like a decade since I did anything, but you know, I'm just a collector, you know what I'm saying? Got the old tapes, old radio shows, and DATs, and CDs, and whatnot, and, you know, probably give you a taste of some stuff later. But, oh, you want to see some shit? Check this shit out here. You see the way it's spelled? That's how it originally was spelled, bro. This is the first demos of the group, back before actually Gore-Tex was even in the group, and back before we changed the name and added a little bit of flavor to it. Yeah, I got it.